Hi, I'm Chris Carr. You probably don't rely on your motorcycle to make a living the way I do, but I bet you get just as much fun and enjoyment from your motorcycle as I do from mine. That's why you need to join the AMA. The AMA goes out there and fights for our rights to ride.
The American Motorcyclist Association. It's Chris Carr and it's you and me. It's nearly 200,000 fun-loving members nationwide. It's the serious motorcycle enthusiast. It's the future of motorcycling. When you send in your $20 dues, you'll get a member pin, card, and decal. A monthly magazine filled with the important news. Trip routing service. Helping Hands program for lost or stranded riders. And the opportunity to ride thousands of road, off-road, and racing events. But you get something more than that. Protection.
I'm an expert dirt track racer. The AMA's experts are government relations specialists who deal with lawmakers, land administrators, and safety officials throughout the United States. Their job is to go in and make sure we don't get a raw deal.
The threats to motorcycling are everywhere, but so are the AMA's experts, spending your dues money to represent your rights. It's a tough and thankless job. It's not as much fun as riding your motorcycle or watching Chris Carr ride his. But aren't you glad someone's doing that job for you?
Regardless of what we ride, we motorcyclists are in this all together. So come on, join the winning team. Join the AMA.
I'm Dave Despain at Ascot Park in Gardena, California. We're here for the 45th running of the AMA Grand National Motorcycle Races, perhaps the last of those races, which began here back in 1959. You know, if you dig down and deep enough into this dirt, you'll be able to find a spark plug out of a Sammy Tanner BSA or a Kenny Roberts Yamaha. All the greats have come here over the years. And indeed, this infield is due to be excavated soon, but it won't be motorcycle archaeologists doing the work. The lease at Ascot is up, and this place is due to be bulldozed to make way for an office building. In the 44 runnings of the Ascot Half Mile, Randy Goss of Heartland, Michigan is the all-time leading winner. He has 5 victories. As we come here for the last of the Half Mile Nationals on this track, one man can tie that record. Everybody's talking about Springer and what a good year you're having, and everybody's hoping to see you win 41. If you could do that here, you'd tie the all-time record for Ascot wins. What do you think? Is that a realistic possibility?
You just said that. I got goosebumps on my arms, you know. I hope so. You know, it'd be great. We did a few changes and stuff, and we've been talking to Randy Goss. You know, he's done really good here. And we talked to him and tried to get a few combinations from him to maybe help us along for tonight, and since it's going to be the last Ascot, it'd be nice to win it, you know. And so like I say, we got him to help us out, and we've been talking with Brent Thompson, his old mechanic and stuff, so hopefully we got a few things under our hat that'll help us out.
For twice Camo Pro champion Scott Parker, a third consecutive crown is the motivation. He could wrap up the championship here.
I'd like to go out here and win this second to last Camel Pro Series race, because it would just make me going into the last race feel that much more comfortable. If I could win it and Chris get third, that'd clinch the 1990 championship for $100,000 that R.J. Reynolds put up. So I'd really like to clinch it here tonight.
Pretty dumb question, really, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. Who wants to go in that last race under pressure? No way. Not me.
The Chris that Scotty referred to, of course, is teammate Chris Carr, second ranked in the points. Third member of the Harley-Davidson factory team, Kevin Atherton, is preparing for shrapnel.
Yeah, you can count on seeing a few spark plugs, nuts and bolts, maybe some brackets off a sprint car come flying at you, but we're tying on some hand guards right now, so we'll be ready. Short
guys, opening ceremonies and a special treat, a gathering of past champions, including Sammy Tanner, winner of the first Ascot National, only man ever to win 3 straight. Sammy, it must have been quite a thrill in 1959. I want to know if it's a true story. Did you actually win that race from dead last going into the first turn?
Well, I ran dead last. Dick Mann and I were having a lot of fun in the back for about 3 laps before I finally realized the race was underway.
All right, Sammy Tanner, we'll meet more of the past national winners throughout the program. But right now, let's go racing. Heat race number 1. the field power off into turn number one. This race featuring the fast qualifier here tonight, and he is the man under the gun. Number 20, Chris Carr, trailing in the national championship point standings by 14 coming into the race. That means that if he finishes third tonight and Scott Parker wins the race, Parker is the national champion. Chris got off on the right foot for sure as he fast timed the place. His fast qualifying lap has put him on the pole here for heat number one, and he immediately jumps out into the lead over the number 53 of Tim Mertens out of Belleville, Illinois. That's Terry Poovey, the Texan, in hot pursuit from third. And in heat race action on the Camel Pro Trail, the top three riders advance directly into the championship main event. So right now, Poovey is the man under the gun. He simultaneously looks ahead to number 53, Mertens, trying to pick off a piece of that second place action, and at the same time defends himself from any approaches from the rear. Doug Chandler, number 10, is your fourth place man. He too is a former Ascot winner, though he hasn't spent a lot of time on the dirt this year, and Chandler has notions of trying to grab that transfer spot. Nice look at Chris Carr up close and personal as he cocks it sideways out of turn two and down the backstretch on this, the final night at Ascot Park. Track conditions very interesting here tonight. You can run just about any place on the oval. There is no clearly identified groove at this point, but it appears that the fast line is on the bottom. That is certainly where Carr is trying to do his business here this evening. Mertens up just a little bit higher. Poovey has been under Mertens throughout this heat race, but has not been able to pull off any kind of a pass. So as Carr begins to stretch out his lead up front, it's still Mertens second, and now Poovey a somewhat more distant third. Chandler has not mounted a meaningful challenge as yet, but keep in mind again that Doug has not done a whole lot of dirt track work this year. He has focused primarily on road racing, and very successfully as he pulled off the Superbike National Championship. A good look there at Poovey, and just as we say it, here comes Chandler putting the attack on Poovey. If he can get around, he's got a transfer spot. If not, he'll be relegated to the semifinal here tonight. Doug is a three-time winner on the half mile, won it in the fall of 86 and the spring of 87. One of those was on national television, and he also won the spring race here in 1989. So the man knows his way around Ascot Park. Right now we're watching another three-time winner, Chris Carr, operate. And there you see the front four as three of those riders are in transfer positions, and Chandler is still looking for the transfer. You also got a glimpse of the crowd here. They are really starting to murmur about the crowd number. The overflow parking is over in the parking lot of the office building off turn one, and they're still counting the gate, but it is a mighty big house here this evening at Ascot Park for this, the final dirt track championship motorcycle race ever on this old half mile. A lot of the former champions, as we say, have turned out, and we're going to be meeting them throughout the evening. Right now, the focus of attention is the 1990 championship battle and Chris Carr's effort to overhaul Scotty Parker in the point standings. Carr 14 down as he comes here tonight and heads into the white flag lap, not wanting just to win his heat, but to dominate his heat for the psychological advantage, and also to win the fastest heat, because that will give him the pole position for the national, and that could be very critical. Starting spot is a big issue in a short sprint race like the 20 lap half mile national. So Carr has won the heat. That's step one. Mertens and Poovey get the other two transfer spots. We'll be hearing from Chris Carr a little later on tonight. Right now, let's hear from Gene Romero, former Grand National champion, who tells us about the memorable night that he won the Ascot National.
It was a great night, to a capper of a good season with the people that was working with me, and we won the championship, and just everything worked out well, and it just a great honor to race here at this facility, and I've been fortunate to be come in here as a spectator, like the people up here in the stands, and some are racers as well. And then I became a racer, and then later a manager, and then I had the luck and the fortunate to work with the Agajanians. And let me tell you, they're one great group of people, and I'm really going to miss this place, but it's a special place in my heart.
Well, that's true for a lot of people, Gene, and we go to heat race number two. This could be a special place for Scott Parker, if in fact he can win the race here tonight and wrap up the championship. He starts from the outside pole as the second fastest qualifier, and he's got a decent hole shot as we go to turn one. He takes it to the top of the racetrack, and that is Rodney Ferris alongside, working the bottom on the Charlie Gardner, Walters Brothers Harley Davidson. It's the factory Harley versus the privateer entry 1-2 as they come out of turn four on lap one and immediately open up a healthy separation. In fact, looks like they want to make this a runaway. Parker not giving anybody any quarter. Looks like Aaron Hill, number 17, who has grabbed the third spot, also the final transfer spot, but he's going to have some company back there as Parker runs her deep into turn one. He goes up high, which is a Parker trademark. He likes the top of the racetrack. Now comes back and squares it off as he goes digging for traction out there. He saw what Carr did in his heat race, and now he, too, will try to establish himself as the fast heat winner and thus secure the pole here at Ascot. I love that turn one shot where you can get out right by the edge of the racetrack and get up close to the action as Scotty flicks that 325 or so pound Harley-Davidson sideways and gets hard on the gas. Ferris in hot pursuit. Rodney still looking for that first national championship victory, and he could put himself in position here tonight to pick it off. He could run up there and get a piece of Parker and win this heat race, but it looks like Scotty has him pretty well covered here early on in heat race number two. We come here, of course, on the heels of such astonishing drama in the championship battle. First, it was the cracked oil tank for Chris Carr that cost him not only the race, but also the point lead at Springfield. And then just a week ago, we went to San Jose, California, and on the mile, Parker crashed in the very first lap, bent the motorcycle all up, came back. They were able to get it fixed, put it on the line, and of course, the rest, as they say, is history. He went on to win an astonishing main event and thus come here with a 14-point lead in the series standings. If this is the first of our AMA videos that you've had the pleasure to enjoy, I guarantee you ought to pick up those other two. Here's your third and fourth place battle. Number 17, Aaron Hill, challenged now on the inside by the 25 of Johnny Cornwell. Cornwell is a Canadian who has focused his attention on 250cc road racing this year. He's a part-time dirt tracker, and when he rides the dirt, it's on the Eakin Sponsauer Honda, which is a very good motorcycle. And he rides as a teammate here tonight to Rusty Rogers. And there's the action as Aaron Hill tries to come back underneath. And number 25, too, is able to use both sides of the racetrack. Cornwell first going low, then going high, and making it work pretty effectively as we see Parker come to the checkered flag. Ferris second, Cornwell holds on for third spot.
Exactly right. Like you say, you know, I was just moving around on the racetrack and trying to find the fast line. So when we get out there, I know where it's at, and I think I might have found it.
And from our confident current champion, let's go to past Ascot winner Mert Lawwill, who says this place meant a lot to him.
Yes, it was. I enjoyed it here. It's actually still my favorite racetrack. And the reason it was the favorite is they ran every week, and it gave me a place to test and to work and learn my trade as a frame builder.
And, of course, Mert Lawwill is also a tuner and an owner, and his man is number 31, Danny Ingram. He'll be in heat race number three as they launch down toward turn number one. Danny's got a pretty good start down there on the inside. He'll be second into the corner, but number 21, Will Davis, has the lead. And now number 23, Kevin Atherton, slides up the inside and takes over second spot. There's Ingram right in the middle of the pack and rounding out that pack and kind of pedaling his way through turn four at good speed is number 57, Rusty Rogers in the blue leathers. And the four of them have a breakaway out front, and Ingram tries the outside. Davis works the bottom of the racetrack. Behind them come number 43, Bobby McDowell, and number 98, Brian Atherton. Up front, the race for the transfer spot is hot. Look at Ingram in trouble there as that thing shakes its head through the corner. He got too much traction. The thing tried to high side him. Now he works the outside. Davis works the bottom. And you can see it's a little tough to hang on to one of these things up top. You get a big handful of throttle around the outside, and you better be prepared for a rough ride. Atherton, number 23, is bird dogging the rear wheel of Ingram. Now tries to square it off and come underneath, and Rogers is right in the middle of it. Three Harley-Davidsons and a Honda, and by far the best race of the night thus far. Davis has set the pace from the outset. Ingram has been his constant challenger, and you can bet that Mert Lawwill has coached him well coming into this event. Remember that Danny is still adjusting to the Harley-Davidson motorcycle after racing a Honda all of last year and through the first half of the 1990 season.
The power characteristics of the two engines are substantially different, and here at Ascot, the real key to a good lap is to keep your corner speed up, keep your momentum up through the corner so that you don't have to rely quite as much on that dig off the turn. You want to come off the corner hot, and to do that, basically, you got to go in hot and then maintain your speed. It's easy to say, it's not easy to do. Ingram is keeping the pressure on Davis, but so far Davis has been cool, calm, and collected on the bottom of the racetrack. And Eddie Atkins Harley is hooked up very, very well. Will's not giving him anything on the bottom. He's forcing him to go around the top. And now Atherton makes a big charge around the outside. Will he pull off the pass? He does. He gets Ingram and goes after Davis. Atherton decides there's nothing happening on the bottom. He's tired of being in line. I'm going to make something happen, and look at the charge. Ingram suddenly falls to fourth as number 57, Rusty Rogers, figures, hey, if Atherton's going, I'm going with him. Here's Kevin around the outside. Davis is there, side by side, down to the wire they come, and I'd give that one to Atherton by perhaps a whisker or a whisker and a half, but Davis was able to pull it back out as they came off the corner. Great side-by-side race, little contact. Davis almost got his leg ripped off, and diving to the inside, Rusty Rogers comes up to challenge Atherton. Whoa, you talk about spectacular action. That was it. Atherton is the leader. Rogers is now the pursuer, but not for long. He goes underneath trying to put the pass on Kevin, and does. Rusty Rogers comes to life. Actually, Atherton is the one who kicked over the bucket and got things started here. Once he went to the front, Rogers said, I'm going with you. You see Rogers fighting that on to just a little bit as Atherton comes back by to retake the lead at the start-finish line. An amazing battle. Davis and Ingram for the moment are forgotten in this two-man war at Ascot Park. Couple of the young stars of the future in American dirt track racing putting on a spectacular show. Out of turn four they come. Rogers has the inside and the lead and the win by about a bike length over Kevin Atherton. That was a spectacular Ascot heat race for this, the final national, and Rusty Rogers came home a winner. Let's hear it if you like that kind of action, ladies and gentlemen. Richmond, Virginia is a long way from Ascot Park. Coming out here for the final national, that must have been a thrill to win that one.
Yeah, it's my first time here, and I loved it. I had great fun out there. This track is a little like ones at home, a little rough, a little slick. I love it. Felt good.
What'd it take to win it? What was the key for you in pulling that one off?
Well, I was trying to run the bottom, and the shortest way to run a racetrack, it didn't work. Kevin was up there high, and he showed me the line, and I just followed him till about two laps from the end and just used his line to get around him.
Let's get a second opinion on what happened out there from Kevin Atherton.
I was putting around out there, and Rusty went by me. I said, oh, no, I better get on the gas. And we fought back and forth going in the last corner on the white flag lap. Rusty, he got a little wheel on me. I tried to come around the outside, but he had a little more momentum off the corner, and I had to shut her down and take a second. I'm happy with the second, though.
You were just putting around prior to that, though. Had everything under control, right?
Figure a speed, sir, Dave.
All right, Kevin, with that, we'll go to heat race number four. Final opportunity for a direct transfer spot in the championship main event. Coming off the outside pole, number nine, Jay Springsteen, will be the crowd favorite for sure. That's been the story all year long here. But he'll certainly have some competition from the number 42 of Steve Moorhead. The spring winner here jumps out front. And number 16, Ronnie Jones, dives into second spot. Here comes Jay on the Bartels Harley-Davidson up the inside to go side by side with Ronnie. Jones hangs on to that spot, tries to challenge Moorhead, who has been the strongest of the half-mile racers this year. And now Jones coming around the outside. He's got a notion to pass Moorhead. It does. He gets the Honda out front and drops Moorhead to second spot for the moment. Steve comes back hard on the bottom. Momentary bobble right there. We'll let Ronnie get away and cleanly into the lead. Jones out of Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, your leader. Moorhead falls to second, Springsteen third in a battle of veteran dirt trackers. Ronnie Jones on the George Jarvis Honda Town entry out of Des Moines, Iowa. As they hit the end of the backstretch, Moorhead's got to be a little bit frustrated by this. He had the winning combination in the April race here, but in this event, he is relegated to second spot and not showing much ability to launch an attack at Ronnie Jones. If anything, he is losing ground. Springsteen's been third from the outset, and he too not able to mount much of a challenge. Ronnie Jones thinking that he's long overdue for a national victory. He has chased the factory Harley-Davidsons of Scott Parker and Chris Carr repeatedly this year, particularly on the mile racetrack, but he has yet to win a national race in 1990. He has been ever so close time and again, but has not yet gotten to the checkered flag first. If he rides the main event, the way he's riding the heat race tonight, he could end that streak for sure. Good luck at Springer, working 3 and 4, looking for his fifth Ascot National victory. He, too, has been close to victory on a couple of occasions this year and has had by far his best national season lately. On this racetrack, Ronnie Jones is trying to overcome a bit of a dry spell. He won back here in the fall of 1985. Moorhead, frustrated for sure, had a perfect combination here in April and has not been able to reproduce it thus far in the heat race, and watches Ronnie Jones disappear to the checkered flag. A big win for Ronnie, who will go into the main event. Moorhead and Springsteen go with him. Congratulations, Jones.
Thank you, Dave. We made a few changes after qualifying. Didn't qualify too well. Most of y'all might have noticed I was down there like fourth off the pole, and really worked good. Changes made seem to work good, and hopefully it'll work good in the final.
You beat some pretty heavy hitters, too, with Moorhead and Springsteen. That's got to bode well for that main event. You confident?
Well, I feel pretty good. I don't know how fast our heat was. Of course, track conditions change, and sometimes that's not always a good indicator of how fast you're going, because the heat, the track may have slowed down, may have speeded up, so I don't know. But, yeah, the bike feels good. Might make one or two little changes, just from what I could tell. You know, during the race, it was bouncing around a little bit. We might make a couple of minor changes and be set to go for the final.
About as big a crowd as we've seen at Ascot in a few years. Does that pump you up, winning for all those folks?
Oh, you bet it does. I love it. Love to see all these people out here. I'd really love to win this race, being it's probably going to be the last one we'll have here at Ascot. I'd sure love to win it. We've had a real good season so far this year, but we just haven't won one, so maybe we can put it together tonight.
Congratulations on a great ride.
Thank you, Dave.
That's Ronnie Jones. He's the winner of heat race number 4. And the record shows that Ronnie's heat was the third fastest heat of the night. He's not the only fast winner suited up tonight. Looky here, 74 winner Rick Hocking out of retirement for one last Ascot. Remembers the night he won it.
You won the national at Ascot.
I'll never forget that. It's I raced with Rex Beauchamp. He was on the Harley factory at the time, and we raced handlebar to handlebar for 20 laps, and I just happened to win it. I was a rookie, and I'll never forget that day.
Nothing like winning at the big racetrack. Let's go to the semifinal highlights now as we look for the winner of each of two semis to make it into the championship main event. And we look, too, at the Rookie of the Year challenger from down Texas way in the gold helmet, sliding up into third spot. Mike Hale of Carrollton, Texas, will attack the 17 of Aaron Hill and the 58 of Dave Durrell. 77 Scott Stump and number 10 Doug Chandler round out that front-running five. They look to be the man on the move at the moment. Here is Hale slipping to the inside and around Durrell, and Chandler coming with him. Three different corners of the country represented in that battle. Hale out of Texas, Durrell from Minneapolis, and Chandler out of California. And also in the middle of that is Aaron Hill, who just came busted back around Chandler to retake the third spot. This, remember, semifinal, 10 laps. We've shortened it up to just highlights here. The highlights include Mike Hale fighting that Harley on the bottom of the racetrack, but giving up the spot once again to Durrell, who rides the Donahue Harley-Davidson right around the top of the groove and hangs on to the lead. Durrell has been at this game a few years, but is having his best Camel Pro season to date, as he has been a consistent main event challenger here. And that consistency is very important in the Camel Pro Series. Motorcycle's got a little wobble as he takes it down the chute, but he is opening up the advantage here, gaining a little ground over now Chandler, who moves around Hale. Chandler's been up and down the ladder here, but as this one begins to wind down, Durrell seems to have established himself as the man to beat. Now the veteran Chandler working on the rookie Hale. Hale has long since locked up the Rookie of the Year honors. He will be the top-ranked first-year expert of the season. Chandler makes one last run at Durrell, comes up a little short. Durrell wins the semifinal. Let's hear from Chandler as a three-time Ascot winner. What about Ascot Park? Are you figuring on being a player here tonight?
I sure would like to be. You know, Tony Dodge and Steve Storrs, you know, prepared a really good bike for me here tonight. It feels really good. I think I just got to get myself up to speed.
You've done well here in the past. You think you might be able to get up to speed before tonight's out?
Yeah, I think so. I think if the heat race goes good, we should be pretty close in the main event.
Good luck to you tonight.
All right, thanks, Dave.
That's three-time Ascot National winner Doug Chandler. As we go to the highlights of the second semifinal, again, the winner will find his way to the championship main event. The second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth place riders are destined to ride the last chance qualifier here this evening. Down the backstretch, the man who jumps out front is the rookie, Steve Rasmussen. He is actually a graduate of the junior division, riding only his second expert national tonight. He moved up for San Jose, but number 31, Danny Ingram, blitzes by him in turn four and takes over the lead. Another graduated junior, number 16T, Steve Beattie, is your second place man as Ingram begins to pull away quickly from the freshman. These kids wrapped up their junior seasons and then graduated to the expert ranks in time for San Jose and Ascot, and they're currently racing for second and third spots. So again, that bodes well for the future of our sport to see that young talent coming up. How about Ingram? Big old long left leg out there, real stiff-legged. Here's the battle now between 16T Beattie, challenged by the veteran Keith Day from Salinas, California. Day comes past the kids and takes over the number two spot. Beattie hanging with it pretty good there, riding the Dealey Harley Davidson. Fred Dealey, of course, is the Canadian Harley Davidson distributor. Rasmussen has fallen off the pace, and nobody maintaining the pace of Danny Ingram. You see the gap back there to second spot. Now, Keith Day had to get through the traffic to have a shot at the leader, so perhaps he can close it down on Ingram before this one is over. Beattie hanging gamely with him. He rode the 750 all season long in the junior division, so he's got big bike experience. Ingram right up to the top of the cushion. It's great to be in this situation, have a big lead in the semifinal. You'd rather not be in the semi, but if you're going to be in it, the best deal you can have is to have the whole racetrack to yourself and be able to sort out your lines for the main event. Keith Day will settle for the second spot here because up front, number 31, Danny Ingram, has him covered. He wins on the motorcycle owned by one of our former Ascot champions that you met earlier, Mert Lawwell. Now we're going to hear from another of our past winners. You've already seen him in action, but we thought Ronnie Jones spoke very well about why this place is so significant.
I'm proud to be here. All these guys, see all these guys that are, that Romero and Aldana and Chuck Palmgren, all these guys that are here tonight. The reason I'm racing probably is back about 1969 or 70. I went and watched the movie On Any Sunday, and these guys for me really were the reason that I'm out here doing this. I told my dad when I was 10 years old that I was going to come here and do this someday like those guys, and he thought I'd grow out of it, and here I am, you know, 20 years later, and I still haven't outgrown it.
All right, Ronnie Jones, here is officially the largest crowd in Ascot history, ready for the Camel Challenge. Let's meet the lineup. Tough a lineup here, I think, for the Camel Challenge as we've seen in a while, and we've seen from the racetrack that you can run just about anywhere on it. Where do you think the line is to win this race? You got any predictions you want to make? You want to share anything with the other five guys up here?
Well, I think whatever line they give you, you know, it's the guy that gets to the corner first, you know, whether he decides to go up top or take the bottom. So it's just whatever's left you're going to have to fill up, but it's going to be hard to get to the top from the inside unless we get a hell of a start.
Go after it, buddy.
Thank you.
Number 42, Steve Moorhead, will come from fifth starting spot. You know, it took you a long time to start winning these challenges. You let your teammate Carr become a wealthy man before you ever started taking those checkered flags. This year, you've been the big gun in Camel Challenge winnings. What's the difference? What's changed?
Well, Steve Moorhead taught me a couple, I think it was Albuquerque 2 years ago, you got to get a hole shot on these challenges, and that was the best thing that he taught me.
So, yeah, you're ready to go out and get one and get $10,000 richer, huh? Good luck to you.
That's right. Thanks, Dave.
All right, Scotty Parker, the national champion, will come from second starting spot. And rounding out the starting lineup, ladies and gentlemen, the fast qualifier here tonight yet again. He says, I'm tired of watching Scotty take those checks. It's my turn tonight at Ascot. Let's hear it for the second-ranked rider in the national championship standings, Chris Carr. How about that? Scotty's taking your lunch a little bit this year. You ready to get back on top of that Camel Challenge box and get another of those $10,000 checks?
Well, certainly would be nice, Dave. You know, Scotty's been taking the 100 grand at the end of the year. Maybe this year's a role reversal. He's won a lot of challenges. Maybe I'll get the 100 grand.
You were the guy who picked the line here in the May race and predicted what the May race was going to turn out to be like. How about tonight for the Camel Challenge? You got a prediction for where a guy wants to run to take home that big money?
Well, your guess is as good as mine, Dave. I've been down at both ends of the racetrack looking at what's going on. Some guys are going fast up high, some are going fast down low, so I think that's going to make for a good race.
I think it ought to be a pretty exciting five laps. Are you ready for it?
Certainly.
All right, well, let's fire him up and go to work then, guys. Chris Carr will start from the pole. The Camel Challenge is ready to roll, ladies and gentlemen. The rest of the Camel Challenge field includes Rusty Rogers, Jay Springsteen, and Will Davis, the fastest six qualifiers, running five laps for $10,000 to win, and we're underway. Moorhead has a pretty good hole shot. He will go to the top of the racetrack. He gives Davis the bottom, and now as they come out of two, who's got the stuff? Moorhead for sure, as he pulls away, and here comes Parker up to challenge Davis for the number two spot. Moorhead went right to the top, as he mentioned in the interview, found the traction, and just blasted around Will Davis. Now Parker uses Moorhead's line to get up into second, now tries to sort of